Non, Carl Pax.
Han hedder Carl Pax og har i mere end 30 år arbejdet som ukendt tegner for Disney. Men den generation, som er vokset op med Anders And, kender ham alligevel. Han er simpelthen den gode tegner. Han er faktisk verdens mest læste forfatter, og der er endda dem, der sammenligner hans værker med selveste William Shakespeare's.
Oh, you mean that I was no better than Bill Shakespeare?
Carl Pax har mere end nogen anden bragt sine læsere til eksotiske steder overalt på jorden. Alligevel var hans besøg i Danmark første gang, han i sit 93-årige liv var uden for USA. Og hvorfor nu det?
If I hadn't stayed home, I would never have written the stories. I would have been out traveling and having a lot of fun. But I stayed home and worked, and now I get all this praise and thank yous from people, and I see that I didn't waste my time.
Nej, det gjorde han bestemt ikke. Pax har lavet mere end 6.000 af denne slags sider om ænderne og deres eventyr. Carl Pax blev født i 1901 i delstaten Oregon, hvor han voksede op på en lille farm.
I was starting to draw when I was just a kid, and I was always looking at examples of cartoon art rather than any other kind of art, and thinking that maybe someday I would have a chance to make a living that way.
Men først skulle Carl Pax gå så grueligt meget igennem. Han havde fiasko som både tømmerhugger, som cowboy og som kyllingefarmer. Han har senere sagt, at hans mange fiaskoer var grunden til, at han blev så god til at tegne den evige taber, Anders And. Men før de uskyldige ender, tegnede Pax vovede vitser til bladet The Calgary Eye Opener. På den her, der siger pigen til venstre, jeg lod være med at bruge briller, indtil jeg havde kapret en mand, og så se, hvad jeg fik.
And I thought, well, hell, I can draw as good as some of the guys that are selling drawings to this little magazine, and I sent them a few drawings, and they bought one of the little drawings, but they didn't buy the joke that went with it. But anyway, I got about either $2 or $3 for it, I can't think, but it was enough to set me off.
Og her spørger tatovøren, hvorfor sømanden vil have fjernet pigen på sin overarm. Svaret fremgår af nederste billede.
Calgary Eye Opener was a magazine that I felt could not last much longer. And Disney's were advertising a little bit by sending out word to newspaper columnists and so on that they were hiring artists and gag writers and so on. So I sent them some samples and got a job.
Well, there still is a very large difference between the risque cartoons in The Eye Opener and
oh, heavens, yes. Oh, I knew I had to make a tremendous change in my style of thinking, but I was able to do it. Versatile enough that I could think of mouse gags and duck gags.
Carl Pax blev ansat hos Walt Disney i 1935. Han skulle ikke tegne, men skrive gags til Disneys tegnefilm. Det var her, han stiftede bekendtskab med en hysterisk and ved navn Anders. Carl Pax opfandt ikke Anders And. Han havde fødselsdag et år tidligere, nemlig den 9. juni 1934. Men det blev Carl Pax, der kom til at forme figuren. Han udviklede den, så Anders And ikke bare kom til at virke som en uartikuleret rappeskralle, men et levende væsen med alle de gode og dårlige egenskaber, som vi alle sammen er i besiddelse af. Det var en udvikling, som blev endnu tydeligere, da Carl Pax holdt op med at lave tegnefilm, og i stedet beskæftigede sig med tegneserie Hæfter.
Yeah.
wasn't the one that made him ill-tempered. He was that way at the time I first saw him. He'd been invented a year before I went to work at Disney's. And I just took the duck as he was handed to me. He was an ill-tempered squawker, and that's what I was working with.
Og de næste knap 10 år arbejdede Bax med at skrive næsten 40 tegnefilm for Disney.
Well, it was very crude artwork. All I did was little drawings. Just, we had little notepads about so big and a blue or red pencil that we drew in and just make a big crude drawing of whatever Donald was doing in this situation and tear it off and pin it up on a big storyboard, which was a 4x8 foot section of Celotex. The push pin would stick them up on the board, and when you had enough of those drawings lined up on that board, you could sit back and read the continuity of that story we were writing. Those storyboards, by the time they were finished, were pretty darn good things, almost like a comic book.
Også filmen om Bambi nød godt af Barks' blide humor.
Kom nu, den er god nok. Se, vandet er stift. Sådan her.
Oh, I may have been the creator of that little incident where he got out there and his sharp hoofs were sliding all over the ice. But we were supposed to do those things.
Pas på begge ender på samme tid. Jeg tror, vi må rette ud. Mm.
Efter 10 år og 40 tegnefilm gav Carl Bach sig i stedet til at tegne til de mange Anders And-blade, der begyndte at udkomme.
I worked on comic books far away from the studio, way out 100 miles away, where the climate was hot and my sinuses all dried up and I became healthy.
When you started working then with the comic books,
yeah,
there was one big difference, and that was that now you could understand or actually read what Donald was saying.
Yeah, I know, and I wasn't going to limit him to just a bunch of squawks. I let him have an intelligible, thoughtful way of expressing himself. I didn't limit him to being a sort of a half-wit.
Was it deliberate that you set out to change him, or did it just happen?
Well, it happened because it had to be done. The duck had to be changed to where he was able to express himself and talk with other characters around him. Oh, yes, it was just extremely necessary that that be done with the duck.
And then you started adding to his family, so to speak, the nephews, for instance.
Well, the nephews, of course, we invented there at the Disney Studios. It was about the second year I was in the story department that we invented the three nephews. But the handling of the three nephews was changed very much in the comic books because, like I had to change Donald, I had to change the nephews to fit more types of situations. I couldn't have them always just chasing each other and being in competition with each other, squabbling and fighting. They had to have a relationship that produced good, pleasing, happy situations.
Was that why you made them woodchucks?
Oh, those junior woodchucks. Yeah, that came about as the kids were showing so much intelligence in some of my stories that I began figuring out how did they get this way. And so I made them members of the junior woodchucks, which were like the Boy Scouts. And they could solve great problems with what they learned in the junior woodchucks. It was a ridiculous little organization, but it worked.
De næste 20 år tegnede Carl Bax i alt 6.371 sider som denne her. Da han holdt op i 1966, var han nået op på den svimlende løn af 350 kroner per side. Det var denne periode, som lavt lønsarbejder, der til med var anonym, at Bax skabte sine mest betydningsfulde værker. Anders And havde han arvet og videreudviklet. Men nu opfandt han sit eget persongalleri med typer som Georg Gearløs og Bjørnebanden, og genistregen den ufatteligt rige gnier onkel Joachim. Ham blev læserne første gang præsenteret for i denne historie, Jul på Bjørnebjerget.
All the comic strips I had seen in the magazines over the years I was a kid, they always had a rich uncle somewhere in the family. And the rich uncle always was talked about as having so much wealth and all, yet it was never shown. I never once saw any depiction of what his wealth would look like. He was supposed to be a rich, stingy uncle, but I saw no evidence of it. I thought if I ever draw a rich uncle, I'm going to show his money, how much there was of it, and what he could buy with it. So that's how I handled Uncle Scrooge. I began showing his money pretty darn soon after I invented him. Began piling up around his desk and getting in his way when he had to go from one room to another.
Swimming in it?
Yeah. Well, I later just developed it to the point where he had so much money in his big money bin that he could swim in it. And he could do it, of course. Did you ever try swimming in money?
No.
As Uncle Scrooge said, there's a trick to it.
Yes, because there's one story where the Beagle Boys tried
it. Yeah, they tried it. Yeah, Uncle Scrooge knew that if they tried it, it would soften their heads.
Even in Uncle Scrooge, they sometimes struck panels from the stories.
Oh, I've had stories butchered.
Is that how you felt about it?
Yeah, that's right. I remember a story in which a planet that was Valhalla, came down close to the Earth. And the ducks were picked up by a cyclone and transported to this big planet, which was up there. The gravitational pull between the two planets was controlled by how much gold there was on Valhalla and how much gold there was on the Earth. And while they were up there, the kids and Donald, I think, persuaded Thor to come down and explore the Earth to see whether they wanted Valhalla to go any closer to the Earth than it was then. And so Thor came down in his chariot with the kids and went over the busiest street intersection in Duckburg. I had all kinds of noisy traffic and smog, and every unpleasant thing that we have here on Earth was in that one big, massive panel. And here was Thor in his chariot coming down over the street intersection. I worked for a couple of days to make that drawing, and it was taken out of the story and I guess wound up in a wastebasket someplace because they needed a little space to print an ad for some kind of sugar candy, I guess. Made me very disheartened.
I 1966 gik Carl Barks på pension, og ved den lejlighed lavede han denne tegning over, hvor dejligt det skulle blive at beskæftige sig med andet end ænder. Men han tog fejl, for hos Disney fandt man ud af, at det nu rent faktisk var en god forretning at røbe, hvem den tidligere anonyme, den gode tegner var. Så pludselig begyndte gamle historier med Anders And, Onkel Joachim og alle de andre at udkomme under Carl Barks' navn. Det hele kulminerede med denne luksusbog, der kun blev trykt i 5.000 nummererede eksemplarer. Prisen er derefter. Carl Barks' popularitet blev stadig større, hvad han fik håndgribeligt bevis for, da han i anledning af Anders Ands 60-års fødselsdag for nylig besøgte Danmark. Fra Tivoli til Nationalmuseet blev han overalt hyldet, som var han en dronning eller en popstjerne. I begyndelsen af 70'erne begyndte Carl Barks at male ænder. Under hans besøg i Danmark var der på Nationalmuseet i København arrangeret en udstilling med 28 af hans ande oliemalerier. Den blev et tilløbsstykke, især den dag, da Barks selv kom og fortalte om dem.
This money bin I painted long after I thought I would never paint another one of the Disney money bins. And I'm surprised I was able to come up with something. I had used up, I thought, every possible way to show that money bin and make it interesting. But I finally thought of the money bin getting so full it exceeded the top of his depth gauge, so that he had to put an addition on the top of it. And here they are putting an addition to add 5 more feet to the height of the depth gauge. This is typical money bin country. You can see the treasures that he has accumulated, jade elephants and vases and golden helmets of various kinds, even an old watch that he took from somebody as security on a loan. I love to paint all that brass and the glitter of the money, and always would hang a rich Persian rug up in the background and ropes of pearls. Oh, it was fun to paint these kind of things.
On the new money bin that you just finished, it took you 8 weeks to do the coins. How many coins, how many weeks did it take to do the coins on this money bin?
Oh, I don't think I was more than, possibly 3 weeks on the coins here. You see, I have a lot of space filled up around here with all this gingerbread.
Den gode tegner er nu vendt tilbage til USA. Stadig lidt forundret over, at så mange mennesker elsker hans tegneserier så højt. Det gav han udtryk for i denne hilsen til os alle sammen, hvor han med onkel Joachim siger, hatten af for Danmark. Men han er jo, når alt kommer til alt, stadig verdens mest læste forfatter, og han er stadig den gode tegner.
And I was not a guy who could think while I was with a group of people. Other guys on story conferences would come up with gags and be very inspired, while my mind would just go blank. But when I was alone, then I could think of all kinds of situations that could be used to improve that particular cartoon. And I guess Walt understood that, because he kept me on there, working in the story department all those years, because he knew that some way or other I was contributing to the success of those stories. Well, you never heard much from me on story conferences.